This month we have been taking the song Jesus Loves Me, and we started a couple weeks ago by turning it on its head. Instead of Jesus loves me, this I know, we thought about the idea that Jesus knows me, this I love. Well, once you change the first line of the song, the butterfly effect kicks in, you lose the rhyming that goes down the line, so you have to change all the other lines of the song. So Jesus knows me, this I love became for my name is written above. And that was the first sermon in this three-part series. Then last week, we looked at the second part, which was washed and saved by his blood's power. Well, let's finish. Who knows what the future may hold. I may come up with a second and a third verse, and a whole new chorus or something like that. But let's just play with this first three lines. Washed and saved by his blood's power, we finished the line with prepped to fly at any hour. I have a simple question for you this morning. Are you ready? Are you prepared? Are you prepped should the time come for you to fly away home? There is a land that is fairer than day, and by faith we can see it afar. For the Father waits over the way to prepare us his dwelling place there. In the sweet by and by, we shall sing on that beautiful shore the melodious songs of the blessed. And our spirits shall sorrow no more, not a sigh, for the blessing of rest in the sweet by and by. To our bountiful Father above, we will offer our tribute of praise, the glorious gift of his love, and the blessings which hallow our days. In the sweet by and by, we shall meet on that beautiful shore. In the sweet by and by, we shall meet on that, we shall meet on that beautiful shore. Who wants to go to heaven? Raise your hand. All right, that's what I thought. Who wants to go right now? That's what I thought. It's not so easy when you put it that way. I'm comfortable saying, I want to go to heaven. But I'm also comfortable saying, I'm secure in saying that, but I'm also comfortable saying, I want to go to heaven, just not right this second. If it happens, fine. I'm ready. I'm just not necessarily ready yet. And that's a subject that I've talked about in various sermons before, but I want to consolidate some thoughts together in one neat and tidy little package. So let's just talk for a little bit this morning. No 3 points, no outline, no sub-points and things like that. Let's just talk about death and victory and heaven and before heaven and all those sorts of things. Not comprehensive. We'll leave a lot of good stuff out, I'm sure. But let's just talk a little bit about some of these things that we all have to think about from time to time. It is common in times of grief over a lost loved one, a departed loved one, for us to contemplate our own mortality. And we think of the day when we will, as Shakespeare put it, shuffle off this mortal coil and bid this world goodbye. And for some, those are thoughts that bring fear of the unknown, fear of what's on the proverbial other side. Some people, it's anxiety, anxiousness, eagerness. I've lost my loved one, I want to see them again. Let's hurry up, let's get this going. I want to get there as soon as possible. I'm ready. But I'm not necessarily ready just right this second. I mean, I'm prepared, but I don't know if I want to go right this second. I'm a Christian, the person says. Hopefully you all will say that. I'm a Christian. If I die right now, I know I'm going to leave this world for a far better place. And that is it should be for you, a true statement. But sometimes we take that true statement to an extreme and we say, because I know heaven is such a great place and it's waiting for me, I want to die right now. I want to go right now and be in heaven immediately. And I don't think it's wrong for me to say, that's not me though. I don't think it makes my faith weak. I don't think it makes my Christianity somehow fractured or less dependent on God or less confident in what's waiting for me on the other side. I don't buy the idea that if I say, I don't want to go to heaven right now, right just yet, there's something wrong with me. Death is not my friend. Death is not your friend. No matter how much you think it may be, death is not our friend. Death is called the enemy that is conquered, the last enemy conquered by Jesus Christ, 1 Corinthians 15:26. Death is a taskmaster, and before Christ came, and before Christ saves us, death is a taskmaster that cracks its whip against us, but it doesn't leave gashes on our backs. It leaves wounds on our hearts. It hurts us emotionally. It hurts us psychologically when we are separated by death from the people that we love. Death is not a friend. Death is not an ally. Death is not a comforting thing. Death is a painful thing. Death hurts. It hurts us right here. It hurts us right here. After the funeral, you get that feeling in your gut and you just feel that emptiness, that hole that's been ripped out of you. That's not a good feeling. That's a bad feeling because death is the enemy. But then the Savior came. And if the Savior has touched your life as he's touched mine, when death happens, it still hurts. But there is that feeling on the other side of the pain that you know is coming. That quiet confidence, that reassurance that yes, it's a loss and yes, it hurts, but I will see that person again. Without Jesus Christ, there is no, but I will see them again. It's just, it's a loss. And a loss hurts for as long as the loss lasts. And without Christ, the loss lasts forever. The power of death over me, the ability for death to hurt me forever, was ended the moment Jesus Christ rose from the dead. And if I am in Christ, that means when I die, I too will rise from the dead, and death will have no dominion over me anymore either. So with that said, what power can death have over me? What hold can it maintain over me? How can I let death wear me down perpetually? I shouldn't. It doesn't have any hold over me. It's gone for good. There is no finality anymore. There is no, this person I will never see again. If that person's a Christian, I know I'm a Christian. There is no gone for good with that person. I will see them again. It's just parting. But it's a parting that is a sweet sorrow. Sorrow because it hurts, but it's sweet because it won't last forever. But you say, so what? It still hurts. Yes, it does. And there's nothing wrong with it hurting. There's nothing faithless about you treating death like the enemy that it is. Jesus stood at the tomb of his friend Lazarus, John 11:35, and he wept. He didn't celebrate. He didn't say, isn't this wonderful? Lazarus is in a better place. He wept. Why? Because death is sad. He wept because all the people around him were sad, and he was, like them, a friend of Lazarus. And that friend had died. It's a sorrow, but he knew, I'll see him again. And just to show all of us, those at the scene and those who read the account, just to show all of us the power that he has over death, he did something that isn't normally done, to keep crying. This is why he doesn't have to stay sad. This person can rise from the dead by my power, Jesus says. And so he told him, Lazarus, live again. Paul wrote Philippians 2:27 about a friend of his named Epaphroditus who was very, very sick, so sick that everyone thought around him, well, he's not going to make it, he's going to die. And his friend Epaphroditus was near death when Paul prayed that God would have mercy on him, that God would spare him, key words, from death. And listen to what Paul writes in Philippians 2:27. For indeed he, Epaphroditus, was sick near to death, but God had mercy on him, and not on him only, but on me also, lest I should have sorrow upon sorrow. Paul says that this was a faithful Christian who was about to die, and I prayed that he would not die, and he did not die, and that's called a mercy. When a faithful Christian doesn't die, it's called mercy. It's called God sparing that person. Paul prayed, God, this person has more work to do. He has more good that he can accomplish. He has more seed that he can sow in the labor of the kingdom of the Lord. I'm ready. Are you ready? I'm not ready yet, though. Now, don't misunderstand. I'm speaking in general terms. I know there are some people who, because of disease, because of personal injury, because of suffering that they have in various ways, that they, being secure in their salvation, they realize death would be a sweet release. And because of the suffering that they endure, the physical pain they endure, the turmoil they endure, they long for the day when they can finally just end the suffering for a land where there is no suffering. I get that. I understand that. And for those people to ask God, please give me that release, I don't think it's a faithless prayer either. I don't think it's an inappropriate thing to say either. But for those of us with strength for another day, for those of us who can continue laboring in the kingdom of the Lord, I don't think it's right for us to sit on our roof staring at the sky waiting for it to split open and Jesus to finally come back already. I don't think it's necessarily okay for us to say, I don't want to do anymore, I'm ready to go right now. The bus hasn't come yet. Keep working, right? The bell hasn't rung yet. You keep working. After all, our instinct is to live, is it not? Is that not a primal thing built into us to want to survive, to want to keep going, to want to live? Isn't that what God has put in us as our Creator? We have this precious gift, the first gift ever given to us by God. It's the gift of life. It's a gift given to you before you even leave your mama's belly. And she knows you have it because she feels you kicking with life from the inside of her belly. You have this beautiful gift. And from then till the time you finally leave this world, your natural impulse is to want to keep living. Again, generally speaking, wouldn't it be unappreciative of us to take that precious gift and want to just be done with it already? this beautiful thing that God has given us just to say, yeah, but I'm finished with it. I want the other thing now. There is sin and there is wickedness and there's all manner of reasons to be discouraged. There it is, a difficult, bad world out there, but we're not supposed to be. We're supposed to be sinless. We're supposed to be encouraging. We're supposed to be a sane, secure, oh, I'm trying to think of the S word again. We're supposed to be a safe, secure, and supremely blessed people, and we show our supreme blessing to those around us. We're supposed to be a light that shines to the world. Well, you can't be that if you're 6 feet under. Keep living. Keep living for Christ. Keep serving. So I know the temptation is to say, it's really, really bad. It's really hard. I just want to be gone. But don't think that. Think it's really, really bad. What can I do to contribute to make it better? What can I do to make this world a little better place before I finally do leave this world? Solomon told his son that by following God, he could have long life. Proverbs 3, 1 and 2 says, my son, forget not my law. Let your heart keep my commandments. For length of days, for long life and peace, they will add to you. In other words, he flat out says, unrighteous people tend not to live very long. Proverbs 10, 27, the fear of the Lord prolongs days, but the years of the wicked shall be short. General terms, obviously, some wicked people live to be 120. Some wonderful Christian people die at a very early age. But generally speaking, if you're a wicked person, if you don't listen to God, you tend not to listen to anybody, you tend to run off into the train tracks and get smacked. Now, I'm ready. I want to go to heaven. I'm going to follow God's commandments. But according to what Solomon says, if I'm reading between the lines, I should want to obey God's commandments so that I will live longer, as though that's what I'm supposed to want to do. As I say, it's a natural instinct to want to keep going. Illustration. Which I don't do often because they're usually personal and they're usually embarrassing. So let's dive right into that bucket. I grew up on a farm. I know that's hard to believe, but just go with me here. There were barns everywhere. All right, and there was one particular barn on this farm that I grew up on that had two rooms, separate by a wall, right? Go figure. And on the right was spiders and snakes and things and terrible things I would never go near. But on the left, it wasn't used anymore because the roof was kind of damaged, and if you shook it too hard, it's just a little barn, that the roof might cave in. So my dad never went in it, so that's where I played. So I would go in every day after school, and I would have my chalk, and I'd draw Zordon from Power Rangers, and I'd play my Power Rangers, you know, the things a six-year-old would do. So I'd go in there, and I'd play, and I'd have my fun. And I would play from the moment I was dropped off after school until the moment the sun started to set, and I'd go home for dinner. And I would play every day like that, but I would never go in that barn after sunset. Why? There might be bears. You know, I would think there might be wolves, there might be werewolves or werebears. There might be all kinds of things in that place. If I can't see them, they could all be in there just waiting to pounce. So I would never go in there. Until one evening, I played and I went back to wash up. I had homework to do. I didn't have my backpack. I left it in my little Power Rangers command center. So I had to go back at night. And there was this little wooden lever thing to open the door. And I lifted it up and opened the door. And wouldn't you know it? Like a haunted house, that door opens. And I'm looking in, and I see nothing. Pitch black, not even a hand in front of my face. And I know my backpack's right in that corner. It's two steps that I can grab it. But I can't see. Between now and those two steps, a hole could have appeared. A portal to another dimension could have appeared. A vampire could be right there. I don't know. I'm terrified. It's the same barn, just with the lights turned off. But not being able to see it, not being able to know, sparks in me a fear. Because I worry, what if something happens bad? What is that? It is the same fear of death. It's the same primal fear we have to want to live. You have that fear because you're supposed to be more cautious in situations where you might die. Your natural instinct is to live. God gave you life. He gave you the impulse to want to keep it. So don't just be ready to throw it away. All right? There's nothing to fear in that barn, metaphorically speaking, proverbially. There's nothing to fear in the barn. It's the same barn. You're going to be okay. Keep living. Trust God. Say this. Did you ever lay in your bed and think to yourself, listen to me, did you ever lay in your bed, or tell me this, not just me, and think to yourself, now I know I'm going to dream, but I don't know what. Oh, before that, I know I'm going to fall asleep, but I don't know when. I know I'm going to dream, but I don't know what. And I know that while I'm dreaming, I'm going to be conscious of the dream, experiencing it while it happens, but then when I wake up, I'll have no memory of the dream. Is that just me? And then what happens while you're thinking all these things, you wake up. And sure enough, you dreamt. You fell asleep, but you didn't know when exactly. You dreamed, but you don't know what exactly. And you were aware of it, but you don't remember exactly what you dreamed. You just fell asleep, and you woke up, and it was a brand new day. That's death. It's not this hand lunging out of the ground, dragging you down. That's just the grave for your shell. Your actual living essence of you, which is not this, flesh and blood, beautiful though it may be, that's not you. You are that thing that can't be seen. You are that spark of life that God has given you. And that spark of life will keep living even after this shell is gone. You will just, well, when it happens, it'll just happen. You'll fall asleep and you'll wake up. And if you're a Christian, it'll be a brand new day. Let me do you one better. Dying in your sleep doesn't necessarily mean you wake up when you die. In other words, you can be alive, fall asleep alive, sometime through the night die, and keep on sleeping through it, and then wake up, oh man, I'm dead. That's a Bible precedence for that. Let me tell you, it's 2 Kings 19. The context is the Assyrian army was surrounded the city of Jerusalem. One day later, they were going to invade the city, ransack the city, plunder the city, destroy the city. They were one day away, the Assyrian army, from destroying Jerusalem. One angel comes down from heaven in the night while the camp is asleep, and that one angel destroys the entire army of 165,000 Assyrians. And the Bible says in 2 Kings 19 that when they woke up, they were all dead men. In other words, when they woke up, they were dead. So they fell asleep thinking tomorrow we're going to kill some Jews. They fell asleep and they died. And they woke up, oh snap, I died last night. That's what happens. That's how smooth the transition is from life to death. Now, if you're not a Christian, you're going to wake up to misery. But if you are a Christian, you'll wake up to just a brand new, more beautiful, more safe, more secure day. That's confidence to me. That's a wonderful thought to me. So I'm ready. I'm prepped to fly at any hour. But in the meantime, I know it's waiting, but I have work to do. I have a few things I want to accomplish before I go. I got prepared, though, when I became a Christian. I believed Jesus Christ, I repented of my sins, I confessed my faith in Christ, I was baptized into Christ, and I have been and still will continue to be living faithfully, so that whenever the end may come, it will come with me faithful and ready. What about you this morning? Are you prepped to fly? Are you prepared to leave this world? You may go to sleep tonight and wake up in the afterlife. You may not even get to sleep. It may happen on your way home this afternoon. Are you ready right now? If not, why don't obey the gospel? Why don't obey it this morning and be prepared? Please come right now as we stand.